Hi, my name is Osama Naga. We'll start a new chapter, Renal Disorders. You can follow with me the Pediatric Board Study Guide in the Renal Disorders chapter from page 373 to page 383. Proteinuria. If you do a dipstick and the dipstick is 1 plus or 30 milligram per deciliter, this is considered proteinuria. Why proteinuria is important? Because persistent proteinuria is a red flag, is a signal of glomerular lesion or glomerular disease. Why is important? Because this can progress to end stage renal failure. So if you do a dipstick, you have possibilities, can be negative, or you can see a trace. Trace means 10 to 20 milligram per deciliter. 1 plus means 30 milligram per deciliter, 2 plus means 100 milligram per deciliter, and 3 plus means 300 milligram per deciliter, 4 plus means 1000 to 1500 milligram per deciliter or more. Clinical approach to a child with proteinuria. First thing to advise the parents to ask the child or to let the child empty the bladder before going to sleep to ensure removal of residual protein from the previous day. The next step is to collect the first morning sample immediately after waking up from the bed to the bathroom before playing, before any activity, in order to ensure the correct collection of first morning sample. Then the next step is to send the urine test for protein and creatinine ratio. So you order protein and creatinine urine test, and then you divide the protein over the creatinine, and this will give you the ratio. If the ratio is less than or equal 0.2, this is normal in a child more than 2 years of age. If you collect the urine sample, the morning sample, and if you do dipstick and is more than 1 plus, or urine protein to urine creatinine ratio is more than 0.2, remember this number, more than 0.2, on a repeat urine morning sample, this is suggestive of renal disease. This is serious. This is requires further investigation. If you have a clinical presentation of a tall adolescent, active, slender body, habitus with significant proteinuria and upright position and resolve in supine position, the most likely diagnosis is orthostatic proteinuria. This is a classic presentation of orthostatic proteinuria. So what to do next? Advise the patient to empty the bladder before bedtime and immediately after waking up, collect the first morning sample and test for urine protein and urine creatinine. So in this case of orthostatic proteinuria, you will see during the day on random sample, you will see that protein to creatinine ratio is more than 0.2 on a random sample. But when you do the first morning sample, you will see the protein creatinine ratio is less than 0.2 on the first morning sample. Proteinuria during the day or activity and disappeared in supine position with normal first morning urine sample. This is a benign condition, requires reassurance, but testing for proteinuria in annual basis is prudent. Very important to follow up on yearly basis, and anytime you see the first morning sample is 1 plus or more, or the first morning sample urine protein to urine creatinine ratio is more than 0.2, this will require further investigations. Let's summarize proteinuria in children. If you have a patient with incidental finding of proteinuria less than the nephrotic range, the next step is to test the first morning urine sample. Send the test for urine protein and urine creatinine. Then divide the urine protein over the urine creatinine, and this will give you the ratio. If the ratio is less than 0.2, this is orthostatic proteinuria. Reassure the patient and repeat UA every year. If the ratio is more than 0.2, this is very important to follow very closely. You need to repeat in 2 weeks. If the ratio normalized or the proteinuria disappeared, this is a transient proteinuria. Reassure and follow. If in the repeat in 2 weeks the ratio is more than 0.2, this is serious. This is a red flag for possible progression to end stage renal disease. This is a persistent proteinuria. Close follow-up is very important. Investigation is very important. So refer to pediatric nephrologist for renal biopsy and management. If you have a case of proteinuria with urine dipstick 3 plus or more, or your analysis showed that the urine protein is more than 40 milligram per meter square per hour, or more than 1000 milligram per meter square per day, or more than 3 to 3.5 gram of protein in 24 hours, or If the urine protein to urine creatinine ratio is more than 2.5 to 3 in a random sample, this is nephrotic range, for example, nephrotic syndrome. If you forget all of these, remember if it's the urine dipstick 3 plus or more, or if the urine test in 24 hours for protein is more than 3.5 gram, this is nephrotic range, for example, nephrotic syndrome. We'll start with the primary causes of nephrotic syndrome. Before we advance further in the renal chapter, I would like to remind ourselves with the normal histology of the kidney, because knowing the normal will make it easy for us to understand the abnormal. As you remember, the kidney is full of filtration units, which is the glomeruli. If we take one glomerulus and look at it here, there is a Bowman's capsule and Bowman's space and the proximal tubule to collect the urine. Inside the Bowman's capsule, there is a tiny capillaries, collection of very tiny delicate capillaries, where is the filtration occurs. These capillaries enter the Bowman's capsule through the afferent arteriole and leaves the Bowman's capsule through the efferent arteriole. Afferent arteriole is a branch of the renal artery, and the efferent arteriole eventually will unite to the venules and then eventually will drain to the renal vein. So the filtration occurs because of the pressure difference between the afferent arteriole and the efferent arteriole. This hydrostatic pressure will allow the filtration. Too much pressure on this side, for example, like in cases of hypertension, will cause damage over time in the kidney and will cause ultrafiltration. Also, like in case of diabetes, damage or thickening or narrowing in this area, this will cause also increasing filtration and, for example, leakage of protein, and this eventually can cause renal failure. If we take one glomerulus and look at it under the microscope with H and E stain, as you see here, this is the Bowman's capsule and this is the Bowman's space, okay, and inside here is the capillary loops. This capillary loops is the filtration units, and this these capillary loops are connected together with mesangium. And also they are divided to lobules, and these lobules also are connected with mesangium. This wall is very thin, and because very important to know that, because some diseases will make it very thick. So this thin wall is the filtration wall, and let's magnify it here and look at it. Is triple layer. The inner layer is well known as endothelial layer in contact with blood. Then basement membrane is a thin and delicate membrane, very important to know that, because some diseases will affect the basement membrane. And then the outer layer, which is the epithelial layer, so endothelial layer, basement membrane, epithelial layer. The other name of the epithelial layer is foot processes or projections, and separated from each other with filtration slits, where is the filtration really occur. So also well known as podocytes, projections, or foot processes. So remember, it's three layers: endothelial layer, basement membrane, epithelial layer, or foot processes or podocytes. Primary causes of nephrotic syndrome, minimally changed disease. Minimally changed disease is the most common cause of nephrotic syndrome in children. The most common age or age of presentation is 2 to 6 years of age. This is the most common age of presentation, between 2 and 6 years of age. So it's very unusual to have this disease present before 1 year or after 10 years of age. Focal segmental glomerulosclerosis is another cause of nephrotic syndrome, and the clinical presentation very similar to minimally changed disease, but resistant to steroids and cyclophosphamide. Another causes membranous nephropathy and membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. At the end of this presentation, we'll be able to differentiate between these conditions. Also very important to know the last three conditions here: focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, membranous nephropathy, and membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis usually progress to end-stage renal disease. It is almost all cases of minimally changed disease is idiopathic. This is the most common cause. It is postulated that minimally changed disease is a disorder of T cells. It produces cytokines. The cytokines will destroy the epithelial layer. If you see here, this is the endothelial layer. This is the basement membrane covered with epithelial layer or foot processes or podocytes. As you see here, is normal and nice, and nice projections. Here is flattened by the cytokine. The cytokines destroyed the podocytes and cause effacement and flattening of the podocytes, and this will cause leakage of albumin in urine and albuminuria, and subsequent hypoalbuminemia. Very important to know that minimal exchange disease can be associated with Hodgkin lymphoma. If you remember Hodgkin lymphoma, it has Reed-Sternberg cells, and Reed-Sternberg cells produces lots of inflammatory cells and cytokines, and these cytokines also can cause the destruction of podocytes and nephrotic syndrome. No wonder why the minimal exchange disease has an excellent response to steroids. The hallmark of minimal exchange disease is proteinuria, more than 3.5 gram per day. It is a selective proteinuria, which is albuminuria, and as a result of that, you will have hypoalbuminemia, and this will decrease the oncotic pressure, and as a result of that, the fluid will collect in the tissue space and cause edema, and the edema initially start in the loose tissue, like in the face, and cause facial edema, especially around the eyes. And later in the day, the edema will progress to the lower extremities, and over time, if the disease is not treated early, it will progress to the spaces like in the peritoneum, and will cause ascites in the pleura, will cause pleural effusion. Also, this will be associated with hypogamma globulinemia, and this can cause infections, hypercholesterolemia, hyperlipidemia, very important association, hypercoagulable state because of loss of anticoagulant proteins like antithrombin 3, protein C, and protein S. This is very important to prevent coagulation. If you lose these proteins, this will put this patient at risk of hypercoagulability, and they can have thrombosis. Very important to know that minimal exchange disease is not commonly associated with hypertension and hematuria. If you see hypertension or hematuria, you need to think about nephritic causes or focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. Classic laboratory findings in cases of minimal exchange disease: 4+ proteinuria in urinalysis or urine dipstick. A spot urine protein to creatinine ratio is more than 2. Urinary protein exceeds more than 40 mg per meter square per hour. Serum creatinine value is usually normal, very important. Serum albumin is less than 2.5 gram per deciliter. Microscopic hematuria can be seen in 20% of the cases. Serum cholesterol and triglycerides are elevated. Very important to know, in cases of minimal exchange disease, the C3 and C4 are normal. This will help to differentiate from nephritic syndrome. Negative serology, negative infections, and no autoimmune disease associated. This is the classic presentation of minimal exchange disease. Very important to know that renal biopsy is not indicated in classic minimal exchange disease. So if you have a classic clinical presentation with classic lab findings, you can go ahead and treat without renal biopsy. Indications for renal biopsy: if the age of presentation is atypical, like less than 1 year or more than 10 years of age, remember, is 2 to 6, usually less than 6 years of age. This is the most common age of presentation. Not responsive to steroids. You give steroids and is still having proteinuria, means that the urine does not become protein free within 6 weeks of treatment with high dose steroids. In these cases, you can go ahead and refer to pediatric nephrologist for renal biopsy. It is very important to understand the electron microscopic picture finding in cases of minimal exchange disease. Let's compare here with the normal. This is the endothelial cells. This is the basement membrane. This is the podocytes or the epithelial layer or foot processes. Here is foot processes. As you see here, this is the normal glomerular filtration barrier on the electron microscope. If we look in, at the electron microscopic picture in case of minimal exchange disease, here is the endothelial layer, basement membrane, and here is the foot processes are flat. The epithelial layer is flat or effacement of foot processes. This is characteristics of minimal exchange disease, and no immune complex. There is no granulation. There is no immune complex in cases of minimal exchange disease. Means that the immunofluorescence will look normal. Management of minimal exchange nephrotic syndrome or minimal exchange disease is empiric trial of corticosteroids. This is the first step in therapy with no need of tissue biopsy. First episode or initial episode of minimal exchange disease, you give prednisone 60 mg per meter square per day. You do not exceed more than 60 mg per day. This is the maximum, divided in 2 doses for 6 consecutive weeks, followed by 6 weeks of alternate day therapy with 40 mg per meter square per day. If this is the second episode or relapse, you will give prednisone 60 mg per meter square per day divided in two doses until the urine is negative for three consecutive days. This will be followed by 4 weeks of alternate day therapy with 40 mg per meter square per day. Test the patient for TB before starting high dose of steroid therapy. Cyclophosphamide can be used if a patient has multiple relapses a year or displays signs of steroid toxicity. Supportive treatment is very important. Sodium restriction, as long as the patient has nephrotic range of proteinuria, water restriction if hyponatremic, diuretics, for example, furosemide in severe edema. Do not use furosemide or diuretics in mild edema because this can cause hypovolemia and complications. Monitor electrolytes. If a child with minimally changed nephrotic syndrome presents with abdominal pain, even with no fever, has to be admitted. Why? Because of high possibility of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, which is a serious infection of the acidic fluid, and this commonly caused by Streptococcus pneumoniae, but also can be caused by E. coli or Group B Streptococci. They have to receive IV antibiotics, for example, third generation cephalosporin or cefotaxime. If the child is having ascites and too much fluid, you are able to do aspiration. Prevention of infection is important, for example, pneumococcal vaccine if not previously immunized. Prognosis of minimal change disease or minimal change nephrotic syndrome, 80 to 90% of patients will respond to steroid therapy within 2 weeks. Minimal change disease resolves in more than 80% of the cases, means that the child will be cured. Not respondent to steroids or recurrent relapses, this is the time you refer to pediatric nephrologist for biopsy and management. You need to consider in this case a focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, and you need to know that focal segmental glomerulosclerosis can progress to end stage renal disease. Focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, usually idiopathic, this is the most common cause. It is a proteinuria refractory to steroids and other immunosuppressive agents, and usually progress to end stage renal disease. Common associations: the persistent proteinuria in older children or adolescents, commonly associated with HIV, heroin abuse, and sickle cell anemia. So if you have an adolescent with HIV or heroin abuse, or a child with sickle cell anemia and they present with proteinuria, you should consider focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. In this disease, if you look at the glomerulus under the microscope, you will be able to understand from the name segmental sclerosis, which is one segment of the glomerulus is affected with deposition of collagen, which is the pink in this area, sclerosis, segmental glomerulosclerosis. So, and one part is normal. Focal means that some glomeruli in the kidney are affected and some are not. Very important to know that minimally changed and focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, they share the same figure under the electron microscope, effacement or flattening of foot processes. Both of them, they do not have immune complexes, so the immune fluorescence will be negative. Very important to be able to differentiate between minimally changed disease and focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. Idiopathic is the most common cause in both conditions. In focal segmental can be associated with HIV, heroin abuse, and sickle cell anemia. In minimally changed, the common age of presentation is 2 to 6 years of age, here adult and adolescents, but can occur at any age. Both they present with massive proteinuria, hypoalbuminemia, hyperlipidemia. In minimally changed, has an excellent response to steroids, here resistant to steroids and immunosuppressive. Electron microscopic figure the same, they share the same effacement of podocytes. Here there is no immune complex in both, so it will be negative immunofluorescence. On a light microscope, you will have in minimally changed normal glomerulus, but you will have segmental sclerosis in case of focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. From the name, it is easy to remember. The prognosis is excellent in minimally changed disease and poor prognosis in cases of focal segmental, and usually they progress to end stage renal disease. In this section, we'll discuss primary causes of nephrotic syndrome associated with positive immunofluorescence, which is membranous nephropathy and membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. Membranous nephropathy, usually idiopathic, but can be associated with systemic lupus erythematosus. Very important to know, if you have an adolescent with systemic lupus and presents with nephrotic syndrome, this is the most likely cause, membranous nephropathy. Infections like hepatitis B, C, malaria, and syphilis, solid tumors, drugs like penicillamine and gold. clinical presentation of membranous nephropathy proteinuria, and this can cause edema. 80% of the cases they have concurrent microscopic hematuria, very rare in children. Presence of hypertension at the time of presentation is a bad sign, is a bad prognostic sign. These patients, they have normal C3, except if they have a systemic lupus. So if the cause is systemic lupus, you will see C3 is low. But in generally, membranous nephropathy, they have normal C3. Diagnosis of membranous nephropathy in the electron microscopic figure. If you see here, you will see immune complex deposition. Immune complex deposition under the podocytes, subepithelial. And as a result of that, the podocytes start to deposit more basement membrane and become very thick. And as a result of that, it will have a dome and a spike. Here there is thickening here of the basement membrane, which is making a dome and a spike. Spike and dome, which is the characteristic word here, subepithelial spike and dome. So remember that for membranous nephropathy. And as a result of this deposition or the deposition granules or complex, you will see this granules or grains in the immunofluorescence. It will be positive. So what positive? Why? Because there is an immune complex. It appears as granules or grains in the immunofluorescence. And as a result of the thickening of the basement membrane in the H&E stain, you will see thickening of the wall of the capillary loops. As you see here, very thick is not, if you compare it to the normal one, very thin and delicate membrane. Here is more thickened. So thickening of the basement membrane on H&E stain. Treatment of membranous nephropathy, salt restriction and diuretics, ACE inhibitor to reduce proteinuria. If the patient is nephrotic, treat with steroids. If no response, try immunosuppressive therapy. It may recur after cessation of therapy. Prognosis, 25% of children progress to end-stage renal disease. Membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. Type 1 is the most common form, and we'll explain the three types in the next few slides. Clinical presentation, asymptomatic proteinuria. This is very important. That's why in the beginning of this presentation, we explained that if you do first morning urine sample and the repeat is more than 0.2, the protein to creatinine ratio, this is persistent proteinuria, and this is an indication for renal biopsy because you don't want to miss this diagnosis. Also, they can present with hematuria, nephrotic syndrome, acute nephritic picture with gross hematuria, recurrent to gross hematuria with intercurrent illnesses. Renal function may be normal or diminished. Hypertension is common. Very important to know that C3 level is commonly decreased in 75% of the cases. 75% of the cases, they have low C3, and this will help us to differentiate this disease from membranous nephropathy. Keep that in mind. We have two important types of membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, type 1 and type 2. The differentiation will be according to the location of the immune complex. If it's subendothelial, this is endothelial, subendothelial, this is type 1. If it's intramembranous within the basement membrane, this is type 2. Type 1 commonly associated with hepatitis B and hepatitis C viral infections. Some recover completely, and 50% they progress to end-stage renal disease. In type 2, it is intramembranous within the basement membrane, commonly associated with C3 nephritic factor, and this will stimulate this complex deposition here in the basement membrane, and it will cause the complication. And this is rare in children, and it has poor prognosis. Both of them, they present with nephrotic, nephritic, proteinuria, hematuria, hypertension, but remember, both of them commonly associated with persistently low C3. A very important keyword for this disease is train track or tram track appearance on the microscopic figure with H&E stain. Tram track appearance, tram track appearance or train track appearance. Why? Because of the proliferation. Remember, is membranoproliferative. This associated with the proliferation of the mesangium. When the mesangium proliferate, will cut in the middle, will split the complex deposition, and will give you this appearance, a tram track appearance. Treatment, 2 years of alternate day steroids followed by repeat biopsy, ACE inhibitor to control proteinuria. No treatment is proven for type 2 membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis in case of end-stage renal disease or renal failure renal transplant. Let's summarize the primary causes of nephrotic syndrome. Here is the difference between minimal exchange disease and focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. Again, the EM finding is the same, which is effacement and flattening of podocytes. Minimal exchange is common between 2 and 6 years of age. Focal segmental is common in adults and adolescents. The microscopic finding in case of minimal exchange is normal. Segmental sclerosis in cases of focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, from the name. Here there is an excellent response to steroids. Here poor response to steroids and immunosuppressive. Both of them, they present the same with nephrotic syndrome, proteinuria, hypoalbuminemia, hyperlipidemia, hypercoagulable state, and normal C3. Both of them, they have negative immunofluorescence. Why? Because no immune complex deposition. The difference between membranous nephropathy and membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, both of them, they are positive immunofluorescence. So immunofluorescence is positive in both because of deposition of immune complex, as you see in both. The deposition of immune complex is subepithelial in membranous nephropathy, subepithelial. This is common in adults but can occur in adolescents because of secondary causes like lupus, hepatitis B, C, syphilis. Nephrotic syndrome is the presentation, nephrotic syndrome or proteinuria. Spike and dome is a key word on EM. You need to remember that spike and dome in case of membranous nephropathy. Normal C3 except if it's caused by lupus. Membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, there are three types. Type 1 subendothelial, type 2 is intramembranous, and type 3 subendothelial and subepithelial. This is common in children and young adults. Asymptomatic proteinuria is a presentation. Also, they can present with nephrotic, nephritic syndrome, hypertension, hematuria. Subendothelial type 1 commonly associated with hepatitis B and hepatitis C viral infections. Intramembranous type 2 is rare and it has a poor prognosis in children. TRAM track appearance is a key word on H and E stain. TRAM track appearance, low C3, here normal C3, here is low C3. The only exception if it's caused by lupus. Lupus nephritis. Lupus nephritis can be the initial presentation in a patient with lupus, or it can be with systemic lupus. Any child or any patient with systemic lupus start to have clinical presentation or laboratory evidence of nephrotic or nephritic syndrome, they should go for renal biopsy. Classification of lupus nephritis: minimal disease, mild mesangial expansion, focal proliferation, diffused proliferation, membranous fibrosis. Clinical presentation: hematuria, proteinuria, reduced renal function, hypertension, end-stage renal disease. Diagnosis of lupus nephritis: positive ANA and positive anti-double-strand DNA antibodies, low C3 and C4. Definitive diagnosis, of course, renal biopsy. Treatment to immunosuppression, and usually has to be aggressive in cases of class 4. Pulse methylprednisolone, cyclophosphamide or mycophenolate usually used. Prognosis: if the child present with anemia in the beginning, azotemia, hypertension, this is a bad prognostic factors. Congenital nephrotic syndrome, this is autosomal recessive. This syndrome presents between birth and 3 months of age. The urine shows nephrotic range proteinuria, heavy proteinuria at birth. More than 80% they are premature. The placenta is enlarged. You can check the placenta after birth. Enlarged kidneys as well. Diagnosis: genetic testing. Differential diagnosis, very important to rule out infections, because these infections like TORCH and HIV can be associated with secondary nephrotic syndrome after birth. Associations: the severe intractable edema, iron and vitamin D deficiency, hypothyroidism because of loss of protein, frequent infections due to loss of immunoglobulins, clots due to loss of antithrombin 3. Management: daily substitution of albumin. Only bilateral nephrectomy is the curative, only, which is a very difficult decision to remove both kidneys. This is the last section of this presentation, diabetic nephropathy. The effect of uncontrolled diabetes and persistently high blood glucose in the kidney, this can be associated with non-enzymatic glycosylation of vascular basement membrane, and this will cause damage to the basement membrane and become leaky, and also will be associated with hyaline arteriosclerosis, and preferentially this will affect the efferent arteriole, and the lumen will become narrower and narrower, and this will create back pressure and increase the glomerular filtration pressure, and this will be associated with leakage of protein, start with microalbuminuria. At this stage, if you give ACE inhibitor, this will delay the progression from microalbuminuria to nephrotic syndrome. When it reaches this problem, this will be associated with sclerosis in the mesangium and will give you this nodule, well known as Kimmel-Steele-Wilson nodule. If this disease continues without control, this can end up in end-stage renal disease or renal failure. All children with diabetes, they have to be screened for albumin in urine. Type 1, the beginning of screening 5 years after the diagnosis. For type 2, at the time of diagnosis. If you have any child with diabetes start to have albumin in urine, like microalbuminuria, like 30 to 300 milligram per day or 20 to 200 microgram per minute, you need to confirm the diagnosis over 3 to 6 months period with 2 to 3 urine samples. So this will confirm the diagnosis. At this time, if the diagnosis confirmed, they will be eligible for ACE inhibitor. This video is only for educational purpose and not intended to direct the care of any specific patient. Please consult your physician or the physician of your child for the correct diagnosis and the proper treatment. None of my videos can be superior or an alternative for the opinion of an experienced and licensed healthcare professional. Thank you again.